I'm Monty Meyer. I'm a psychiatrist here in the Division of Psychosocial Oncology and Palliative Care, and I'm excited to be here. I've actually been really interested in Chemobrain since I started working here because my focus is on breast cancer, breast oncology, and there's a lot of Chemobrain there, but I also have realized that it pertains to a lot of different cancer types. So I've been doing some research and really seeing a lot of patients who have it to breast cancer patients in Concord, so there's going to be a lot of references to breast cancer here, but I'm going to try to put in some, you know, comments that relate to other cancer types too, because it's equally relevant in those other cancer types. And the other thing I want to do is kind of make this, I want to give you sort of a little bit of, think of it like high school science or middle school science. We're going to sort of go back to those days of sitting in science class a little bit, you know, to kind of give you an understanding of the brain. And, you know, if you're having any Chemobrain symptoms, like how that fits into how your brain works. So we have a small group. So if there are any really pressing questions, you know, at least for those of you who are here in person, like we can feel free to interrupt me. We can address them. Also on your cards, you can feel free to write any questions that you have about the topic, and we'll come back at the end and sort of handle like all the questions for the group. So, all right. So let's get started. So here's how I'm going to focus this talk. I'm first going to talk about kind of what is Chemobrain, what do people experience with it, and what's sort of the impact on people's lives. Then I'm going to talk about why we studied breast cancer in particular, why not study some other cancer type. And then I'm going to kind of tell you a little bit about the research, just so you understand what has been done and what's being done to understand this better. And then at the end, we're going to talk about interventions, like how can you help yourself if you have this? How could you develop a program for your own Chemobrain? So I want to kind of go over the symptoms in more detail, but again, kind of going to the big picture for a sec. You know, I think there's three big questions about Chemobrain, right? So you guys are saying, like, is it real? Or am I just getting older? Do I notice it more? You know, so is it real? You know, if it's real, what causes it? And then, you know, what everyone wants to know is what can we actually do about this? If you find out you have this, what can be done? So again, that's kind of the big picture that we're hoping to get to here. So I'm just going to share a couple quotes that I have compiled from some patients that I've seen, and similar quotes have been actually studied in papers. People have done research and looking at what survivors notice with Chemobrain. I've actually had some patients tell me that they can get lost when they drive, that they, you know, they've actually noticed that it's harder to get places. Some people have had fender benders in the Dana-Farber parking lot, which may be something that would have happened anyway, but again, who knows? I mean, I think people notice that driving may be more difficult in a lot of different ways. And then sometimes people have trouble even doing things like paying bills. Now, these are more severe examples, I would say, but they can happen with Chemobrain. And obviously, these things have a big impact on people's lives. So just a couple areas there. And, you know, I think one of the big things that people struggle with is if they're experiencing these symptoms, you know, it's hard sometimes when you feel like your doctors don't really know what this is, whether it really exists, if your doctors aren't really fully acknowledging it as a side effect. So that can produce distress. Sometimes your family doesn't really know what to make of these symptoms. Like, they'll kind of ask you, like, when are you going to be better? You know, your cancer treatment's over. Why are you still doing this? So that can be frustrating. You know, a lot of people have to go back to work after taking some time off, and then, you know, you're going back to work, you already have a lot of physical things going on, and then you add on top of that these cognitive things. And then, you know, understandably, a lot of this can produce depression and anxiety if you're struggling with, if it's taking a lot more effort to perform at the level you used to cognitively. So these things have kind of a wide impact on people. So now I'm going to get to those symptoms that you guys talked about. So basically, Chemobrain can affect many different areas of cognitive function, a lot of which you guys very eloquently mentioned in some of the symptoms you've had. So I think short-term memory is one of the really common areas. Like, people feel more absent-minded, need more reminders from family to take care of things, need to write things down a lot more, whereas previously might not have had to do that. Sometimes it's harder to pay attention to really complex things or to pay attention when a bunch of things are going on at once. I didn't write it here, but certainly someone mentioned word finding. Word finding is a big is really commonly seen, where you substitute with a word that's similar but really not the word you wanted. That's very, very common. And then this thing called executive function. So executive function is kind of the master capability of your brain to like do complex tasks. So executive function has a lot of different parts to it. One of them is like, How do you start a task? How do you plan a task? How do you organize your tasks? How do you multitask? And then how do you sort of prevent yourself from doing things that are inappropriate? So by response inhibition, I mean, like, let's say you're frustrated with something. How do you restrain yourself from just, you know, lot of different parts, and Chemobrain can actually hit a lot of these different parts of executive function. So now I'm going to move on to a little bit of the research, just to give you some background on what we know about Chemobrain and cognitive symptoms. So basically, the research out there shows that most patients who get chemotherapy do have some kind of cognitive side effects. So if you've had this, you're definitely not alone. So these graphs that I'm showing you are from a study that was done of about 500 patients. And these were patients with all different types of tumors, and they were receiving chemotherapy for their tumors. And what they did was they kind of looked at patients, they asked patients if they were having problems with their memory and problems with their concentration. And basically the level of difficulty, like 0 was no problems, and 10 was like extreme horrible problems, right? So if you look at the graphs, like on the left graph, you can see that even before people started on chemotherapy, they were having some problems. People were kind of averaging a 1.5 or 2. They were having some difficulty. And this might be just maybe aging or maybe just the stress of getting diagnosed with cancer. It could be a number of things. But what you can see is the complaints really spiked for patients who were on chemotherapy, more so than patients who just got radiation. So, and then if you look at 6 months post-treatment, people still have more complaints than they did pre-treatment. So essentially, like, you know, patients aren't totally better at the six-month mark. And you can see similar patterns for concentration, similar to memory. And I think one thing worth noting here is that people are having pretty mild problems overall. You know, if 10's the worst, people are sort of, you know, 0 to 3.5. So, you know, it's mild, but it's still significant. So for most people, the good news, and the one that some news I'm going to emphasize, is that Chemobrain gradually disappears over time. And basically every patient has their own time course for this. Like everyone's sort of on their own curve. You know, some people are going to feel better within a month. Some people are going to feel better within 6 months. Some people it's going to take a few years. You know, I would say the average is like between 6 and 12 months is when a lot of people start to see some improvements. But essentially, like, you know, I think there is a minority of people who will still have problems after the end of chemotherapy. And interestingly, there's been some studies that have been done looking at people's, volumes of people, different areas of people's brains. And they've actually found that some areas are slightly smaller after chemotherapy. But the same studies have shown that these volumes actually go back to normal or improve by 3 years after chemotherapy. So it seems like the brain I'm just going to have a little segue about the brain for a minute. So you might wonder, like, so what is actually going on in your brain if you have these types of symptoms? So basically, your brain is comprised of a lot of areas that are interconnected and that work together closely in order to enable you to function at your highest level cognitively. And one of the parts that's really, there's some pathways in your brain that are really important for Chemobrain, basically that connect the frontal lobe of your brain, which is sort of up here, pretty surface and also a little bit deeper, and the subcortical area of your brain. And the subcortical area, you can just think about it being really deep within your head, like almost in the middle. Like I couldn't point to it because it's so deep in there. But there are interconnections between the brain, pathways that connect the functional levels of the brain. And basically, like, these networks that go from your frontal lobe back into the middle of your brain are the ones that seem to function less efficiently in chemobrain. Now, you're not actually losing any brain cells, and I'll give you some more information about that later. You're not losing brain cells, but it seems that the connections between these different areas of the brains may not fire as efficiently, which leads to some of these symptoms that we've talked about, like having trouble finding words, having trouble focusing. So the other big point is that chemobrain is not the same as dementia. So people always ask me when I see them for chemobrain, like, does this mean that I'm at higher risk for developing dementia? Or, you know, or they'll say, like, oh, my mother had dementia. Does this mean I'm going down that path? Now, if you get an evaluation and it's felt that you could have, that your symptoms could be due to chemobrain, basically it shouldn't be progressive. So you shouldn't be getting worse and worse. Like, the good news is you're going to get, you know, you're not going to get worse. It does not increase your risk of getting Alzheimer's, so they're kind of separate types of things. And then also, like, actually what's going on with your memory and cognition in Alzheimer's is very different from what's going on with your memory in chemobrain. So in Alzheimer's, like, I'll give you this example. Like, when I test people in my office, I often will give them, I'll give them five words, and I'll say, repeat these words. And then I'll say, in 5 minutes, I'm going to ask you to tell me these words. And then I'll distract them with a bunch of stuff for 5 minutes, and then I'll see if they remember the words. So if I was doing that in someone who had Alzheimer's disease, the words are pretty much gone. They're going to say, I don't remember any of them. I can give them, you know, then I'll give them some clues. I'll try to, like, see if I can dig it out of their memory. They're gone. So that's the case in Alzheimer's. In chemobrain, though, often if I give people a clue, like, let's say the word was blue, and I say it was a color, like, oh, yeah, blue. So usually, and that's something that can work to your advantage, right? So if you know that cueing does help you, then you can use those cues to your advantage once you realize that that's helpful. So it actually is very easy to distinguish Alzheimer's from chemobrain if you do testing, which we'll talk about more. So, okay, this is like the best slide in the whole talk, so I'm going to take a long time to describe it. So basically, this is a study that was done on two twins, and these were 62-year-old twins who are identical twins. So they have the exact same genetic material. One of the twins had breast cancer and had chemotherapy, and the other twin did not have breast cancer and didn't have chemotherapy. 2 years after breast cancer, the twin who had had chemo and had breast cancer was complaining of chemobrain, and the other twin was, like, basically doing fine, although they were both getting old. You know, they're both over 60. So what they decided to do to sort this out was they put both twins in a brain scan, a brain scanner, to sort of look at the activity of the brain when doing different tasks. So what they had the twins do was they were scanning their brain in real time, and they had the twins do this task where they were giving, like, a list of letters. And there was, like, a target letter, like the letter was, like, F. And so you had to, like, press a button if the letter was either the same as the target letter, F, or if it was the same letter that was presented three letters previously. So to me, that seems pretty tricky. Like, you're getting this long list of letters, you're supposed to match it up with either some target or what you heard. So you have to pay attention, you got to focus, you got to have a good response time. So these are a lot of the areas that you would expect to be affected in chemobrain. So what happened was very interesting. So the twins actually did the exact same. Their performance was equivalent. They both got, you know, they both made about the same number of errors. However, twin A in this picture is the one who had cancer. Twin B is the one who didn't have cancer. Twin A, you can see that there was so much more activity in different areas of the brain than in twin B. Like, she was lighting up these large areas in the brain as compared to twin B. And so what we think might have been going on is that one thing that people with chemobrain tell me is that things seem a lot harder to them, like a lot more difficult, take a lot more effort than they used to. So it seems like twin A, who had chemotherapy, was needing a lot more to activate a lot more of her brain to do the same tasks. And so this would sort of explain why maybe if you go have testing, you don't do that badly, but you're experiencing things as really difficult. Because of these brain activation patterns. So this is just, you know, it's just two patients. It needs to be done in more patients, but it's very interesting and suggests maybe what's going on here. All right, so those of you who don't have breast cancer are probably sitting here thinking, does this even apply to me? Maybe I should walk out. So basically, this applies to all cancer types, but there's a reason why most of the research is in breast cancer. And the reason is that it's a very common cancer and there are lots of survivors, so we have a lot of patients that we can look at in our research studies. The other reason is that a lot of patients with breast cancer are going to have a good chance of being cured, and they're going to have a low chance of having their cancer come back, a very, very low chance of having their cancer come back, like in their brain. So we're not kind of dealing with problems where the cancer might be affecting the brain in some other way, and so it's easier to study whether chemo is causing the problem, right? And then the other thing that's good about breast cancer is, you know, some patients don't need chemo. They need radiation or they need surgery. They don't have to have chemo. So you could ask the question, like, you know, maybe it's not the chemo. Maybe it's something about the cancer that causes the cognitive problems. Didn't get chemo and compare them to patients who did get chemo and see, you know, really what's causing these problems. So those of you who have this might be wondering, well, why is this all so murky? Like, why don't more oncologists like study Chemobrain and why don't we know more about this? So I've done some work with I've done some different types of research and I've seen the types of research that oncologists do. And when oncologists design studies, a lot of times what they're looking at are some very clear endpoints of their studies, right? They want to see how long people survive. And how long people survive without their disease coming back, you know. So these things are called, like, overall survival and progression-free survival. So, you know, that's pretty easy to study. You give someone a treatment, and you see, like, you take two groups, and you see how well people do, right? How long people live. Very objective. What should be our endpoint? So I'll tell you about a few possible endpoints that people are thinking about using. One is, you know, sort of looking at, you know, putting people in a brain scan and seeing how their brain lights up. That was sort of the twin study that I just told you about. That was an example of a study that used the fMRI findings as their endpoint. So you can just see how the brain's working. You could also do neuropsychological tests. That's sort of a long battery of tests involving, you know, you meet with a neuropsychologist and they test your memory and concentration and focus and put you through a lot. Those are very objective, right? They, you know, you get results like a test. However, they might not reflect real life. So it's not clear to me that sitting down and taking a bunch of paper and pencil tests necessarily reflects like how you're doing with your job, how you're doing, you know, in your day-to-day life. And then the other endpoint you could just use is like, you know, what are you guys complaining about? Like, what problems do you notice with your memory and your focus and your concentration? So that might have other causes. So some of those, we're going to talk about like problems with sleep and depression and anxiety and other things that can cause those problems. But interestingly, like in the research that we have, it seems like, you know, people's problems that they self-report are most similar to the results of the fMRI scans. So it's interesting. It's maybe what you're reporting is related somehow to how your brain is activating itself. I guess the main thing is I want to emphasize that, like, you know, you might be frustrated if you have this and your oncologist is like, well, I don't know, there's nothing to do about it. Like, we don't know if it exists. I think it's really important to know where they're coming from. I mean, where they're coming from is that the research on this topic is really confusing. There are no FDA-approved treatments for it yet. So again, like if you're thinking from their standpoint, they don't know what to recommend if there's nothing that's really been approved yet. So it's hard for them to know exactly how to handle it. '80s, early '90s, and there's been more and more research since then. But you know, it's a pretty recently researched area, so there's not a whole lot that's been done. So when people first started studying Chemobrain, what they would do is they would take people who were survivors, such as yourself, and they would ask them about, you know, their cognitive symptoms, and then maybe they would do some neuropsychological tests to see, you know, what was really objective and what wasn't. But the problem with that kind of study, right, is that it's cross-sectional. And what that means is that you're looking only at patients who already finished their cancer treatment. So you don't know if those patients might have had problems. Good way to design a study. The other thing you could do is, so the best way would be to test people before their chemo and after their chemo, right? So you could look at people who, so you could try to look at people only who had cancer and got chemo. But then, you know, you don't cancer and no chemo. We should be comparing the people who have cancer and chemo to those people, just healthy, normal people who are aging. And we should also look at people who had cancer and who had just surgery or just radiation and no chemo, so that we can really sort out what is the chemo doing. So that's also a problem if you're not looking at those other groups. The other thing is it was really hard to get patients to sign up for the studies, because, like, who wants to sit around for 5 hours and take a bunch of tests if, you know, no one's paying you for it and you have other things to do in your life? So we didn't have very good numbers in our studies. Also, they would compare, like, different types of chemos. So some of the patients would have gotten, you know, AC for breast cancer. Some of the patients would have gotten FU for colon cancer. Some patients got things for, you know, having leukemia or lymphoma. And you can't compare those things. They're different treatments, right? Also, like, for, you know, for breast cancer and prostate cancer, there are some hormonal therapies, like tamoxifen, Arimidex, Lupron. And if you don't account for those things, you have another variable coming in that you didn't really take into account. So, you know, when you're in school and you take tests, like, you get better, you tend to get better with practice, right? Once you know what a test is like, if you take it a few more times, most people are going to do better. So when you're designing a study and you have to test people at different intervals, like, let's say you test people at 0 months, 3 months, 9 months, 12 months, like, let's say you still have Chemobrain, but you're getting better with the test. So it looks like you're improving on the test, but you don't feel any better. So one of the important things to control for is just people who are practicing tests and getting better because of a practice effect. Sleep. Now, I think a lot of people have those problems, like, after cancer treatment. So if you're excluding those patients, you're excluding, like, most of the people for whom this is relevant. So I think that we weren't looking at enough patients when we did these types of studies. So the basic point here is apples and oranges. Like, a lot of the old studies are, it's like trying to compare apples and oranges. Right, this is also a very busy slide, which I'm going to break down for you. So I wanted to summarize some of the research that's better quality that used neuropsychological testing, so the objective testing batteries. So basically what these studies, what 5 of the 8 studies showed was that patients did have declines, and they would have objective declines in their verbal memory, their visual memory, processing speed, so like how fast can you do things. And sort of even your fine motor skills. So that might explain some of the things about driving that I was talking about. Like, if you're having troubles with these things, maybe you get lost more when you drive. Maybe it's harder to, like, have a good reaction time, like, you know, if you hit a yellow light or whatever. So, but those things did improve over time, which was good. And it seemed like chemotherapy had a specific negative effect on verbal fluency. And this is that word-finding thing that we talked about. So, you know, when you're substituting words, you can't come up with the right word. That was seen as a particular studies. Patients who got chemotherapy and tamoxifen seemed to have, you know, more cognitive symptoms at later time points than mm-hmm. patients who only got it. But then the interesting thing is that there were actually 3 studies that were negative, and what that means is that they didn't show any cognitive impairment. So this became very confusing for oncologists, right? They're like, what's going on here? Like, the studies aren't even all showing the same results. A couple additional observations, one of which was just made, is that some people with breast cancer, and probably with other cancer types as well, have cognitive problems before they get any chemotherapy at all, which is very interesting, right? So you have cancer, and you're already complaining of stuff, and you haven't even gotten the chemo yet. So there's a couple theories for this. One is that, you know, you've just been diagnosed with cancer and you're totally overwhelmed and tearful and anxious and there's, like, so much going on. And so you have cognitive failures just because of the anxiety. And that makes sense to me. The other reason is that you might have had surgery, you might have had a lumpectomy, anesthesia, and maybe they didn't get it all and they had to go back in and do another surgery, so you got anesthesia again. So all these, you know, cumulative effect of having anesthesia a few times may, you know, impact your cognition too. And then, you know, it could be that that the tumor itself biologically is causing some of this, and we call that sort of paraneoplastic. But, you know, could it be that just having cancer in itself is a risk factor for having some cognitive symptoms? So I'm now going to go back to, I think someone talked about the blood-brain barrier earlier, so I'm going to go back and talk about that, but I'm going to lead up to it a little bit with a little bit more, like, about your brain. So we talked already about the frontal and subcortical networks. The other really important part of your brain for cognition is your hippocampus. So the hippocampus is like, again, it's a part of the brain that I can't point to. It's quite deep, sort of, it's above your ear and it's deep in there. But it's in your temporal lobe, which is one of the lobes of your brain, and the hippocampus sits in the middle of it. And the hippocampus has a bunch of special parts to it. Interestingly, like if you look in that right slide, the amygdala is like a small part of your brain that sits right next to the hippocampus, and the amygdala is the part of your brain that drives like fear and anxiety. So it sits right next to your memory centers, interestingly enough. But basically the hippocampus has a few different parts to it, and this part called the dentate gyrus is a part which has, it looks sort of really helps you form new memories. So when you are kind of hearing things in your day-to-day life and needing to remember them, this is the part of your brain that helps sort of consolidate it as something that you need to remember. So what chemotherapy regimens, I'll connect this in a minute. So what chemotherapy regimens do most people get for breast cancer? The usual regimen is AC and then Taxol. So, you know, A is adriamycin or doxorubicin. C is Cytoxan or cyclophosphamide. Usually people get AC and then they take, you know, they either go right to T or they take a little break and then get T. T is Taxol to paclitaxel or Taxotere in some cases. So this is the regimen. And other types of cancers we'll add in here in a minute. What is the blood-brain barrier? Because we were thinking, like, so we want to know how this really happens. Like, how does chemotherapy really cause a problem? So it would be helpful to understand whether these chemotherapies can go across the blood-brain barrier, right? So the blood-brain barrier is a very, it's a very sort of intricate structure in your brain, which has cells and sort of areas where that will keep out a lot of things. So the basic point of the blood-brain barrier is to like prevent things like bacteria or like larger objects and viruses, bacteria, from being able to enter the brain. And also like the way that it works is the blood-brain barrier has it's kind of composed of a lot of fatty compounds, like a lot of like lipids, fatty compounds. And the way that it works is like things like that can possibly go across, but generally things that are more hydrophilic, like things that like water, have a harder time getting through. But you can see here from this diagram that, you know, even though it's supposed to like keep things out, there are a lot of ways that things can get in. So you can see things can go right across, things can get transported in, things can get like, you know, go through the side. So there's a lot of ways for things to get in, even though it protects you against bad infections and stuff. So, you know, you might wonder which chemotherapies could cross this. So basically, Cytoxan, which is the C of AC, and also 5-FU, which is 5-fluorouracil, which is often used in the treatment of colon cancer, those things can cross the blood-brain barrier. That's been shown. On the other hand, the A of AC, adriamycin, and also Taxol, they don't directly cross the blood-brain barrier. So, you know, some do, some don't, right? So then you might ask, like, let's say that I only get the ones that don't cross, will I not have Chemobrain? That's the next question, right? So some people set out to examine this. Busy slide, I'm going to walk through what they did here. So this is a slide that was done in animal research. So, you know, we want to be cautious about animal research because it's not necessarily going to directly apply to humans. But it can often give us some clues into how things work in humans, so we still like want to do it and think it's interesting, and it will sort of guide doing more studies in humans. So this is a study where they took mice. They actually had they had two groups of mice. One group of mice, they actually had five groups of mice, but one group of the mice was like the control group, and that group would inject saline into the mice. In the other four groups, they would inject chemotherapy, either 5-FU, C, Cytoxan, Taxol, or doxorubicin or Adriamycin. And what they did was they, a day after they gave the mice, either the mouse, either the chemo or the saline, they would inject the mice with like a tracer that would like bind to neurons in the brain, and specifically neurons that were in this dentate gyrus of the hippocampus, which we talked about, the memory center. So essentially what they did was they, after two more days, they sacrificed the mice, and then they took the mice, the mouse brains, and they let them incubate for a few days. And then they examined the brains. And what they found is that, so if you see those pictures, like the black areas are like areas of, those are like cells proliferating, you know, sort of new, the formation of new neurons. So in the saline group, you can see sort of a fair bit more black. So there's more, there was actually reduced cell growth for all of the chemotherapies, not just the ones that crossed the blood-brain barrier. So it seems like there even could be some kind of indirect effect, whereby even chemos that don't cross this barrier could produce reduction in cell growth. Now it's important to remember that like there actually wasn't any cell death. Like chemotherapy wasn't killing the cells; it was just kind of slowing their growth, you know, a few days after the chemotherapy was given. But it's very interesting, and it's something that we, you know, although we may never do this in humans for obvious reasons, no one's going to die for this. I think it gives us some clues into what might be going on. Okay, so this is sort of what we were talking about with this. So even the chemotherapies that don't go across the blood-brain barrier might result in like sort of less growth of the neurons. You know, if you think about that research, like that I just told you about, like is it possible that some sort of growth factor could help? If there was some growth factor that was just only for neurons, could that help people's chemo brain? Maybe, but the problem with that is we're a little bit uncomfortable with giving growth factors if we're not absolutely sure how they work, because what if they make the cancer cells grow? So we'd have to be darn sure that if we were thinking about getting a growth factor, that it didn't cause the cancer cells to grow faster. So people know that with Neulasta, but they don't know that with some of the other things, like the neural. There are some neural growth factors, like you know, brain-derived neurotrophic factor called BDNF. So, but we just it would have to be done. You know, we would have to know more about this before we could just give people like neural growth factors. Another way you can look at chemobrain that I find kind of a good image to use is that this sort of image of like a seed, soil, and pesticide. So in this analogy, like the cancer is the seed. So there's something going on with the cancer, like it's planted in your soil. So you know everyone has their own soil, right? You know, you have your own genetic qualities, you have your own strengths and weaknesses. It's like your own kind of personal things that you bring to the table. And then the pesticide is chemotherapy. So, I mean, then that comes in. But I think the idea here is all these things sort of interact to produce the chemobrain that we see. It's not sort of a simple, like, one thing causes the problem. So the other thing that goes on is that, you know, both cancer and also chemotherapy results in increased production of inflammatory chemicals. And those are called cytokines. This is something that we see with both of those things. There's a couple names for them. One of them is called TNF, tumor necrosis factor. And there was a study last year that was presented at one of the oncology meetings, which suggested that the patients who have higher levels of this TNF, so if for some reason your body is pumping out more of this inflammatory chemical in response to either your cancer or to your chemo, that you might have a higher likelihood of having cognitive problems after your chemo. So in the same study, they also saw that some women had genetic differences in the gene that that makes TNF that made these women less likely to develop problems with their memory and concentration. So the question then is, like, what are these differences? Like, why are some people genetically protected and some people aren't? So here's some more. This is a little bit more biology for you guys. So basically, like, DNA, and DNA makes genes, there can be slight variations in the DNA. So like one tiny part of it is different. it still kind of makes the same, it still sort of has the same purpose. The DNA still does the same thing in the body, but it's a little bit different. And it turns out that these small variations can make us differentially susceptible to different diseases. And this extends beyond cancer. This can apply to a lot of other diseases, too, like even Alzheimer's, for example, but also just other, you know, unrelated issues. So there are a number of these variations out there. One of them is there's a particular variety of apolipoprotein, which can make people more susceptible to getting Alzheimer's disease. We don't really use this clinically because we don't know. We can't really do it. We can't do a lot about it because it's just kind of the way your genes are. But it is something that is sort of a risk factor for getting Alzheimer's. So it turns out that in cancer patients, like some of these variations may make some people have more difficulty repairing DNA damage. So, you know, when you're, there's DNA damage happens all the time. It could happen when you're out in the sun. You know, that's how people get melanoma. It can happen just randomly. I mean, it's just with the aging process, you can have DNA damage. You can also get it from cancer and from chemotherapy. But if you're kind of unlucky and you have one of these variations that is not so good, you might have a harder time repairing the DNA damage that causes these problems. So the other thing I wanted to talk about a little bit was hormonal therapy. So probably some of you have been through menopause, and you might remember or have experienced that, you know, sometimes when you're going through menopause, you can become a lot more flaky and like, have a hard time finding words and have memory problems. So, you know, people have studied the effect of estrogen levels on memory, and it seems that overall, like, having high levels of estrogen around increase your memory for words, your word fluency, and sort of your fine motor skills. So, you know, any patient who has a really fast menopause, like, you know, that was if you had to have an oophorectomy for some reason, or if you had to have chemotherapy and then they shut down your ovaries with Lupron or whatever, people can often have some declines in their memory for their word finding, their verbal memory. So another important thing to note, though, is that So sometimes you wonder, will this make me demented or whatever, because I had to go through this kind of menopause. It seems to be, it doesn't seem that it's necessarily clear that getting hormones would even protect you from dementia. So it's not quite as clear cut as, like, you know, more hormones, less likely to get dementia. However, like tamoxifen and aromatase inhibitors may have sort of an anti-estrogen role in some areas of the brain that could affect your cognition. So we don't think that these effects tend to be that severe, and they're not that widespread, but they can be seen with these types of treatments. And they're usually seen with, like, again, memory for words, verbal memory, and with processing speed. So moving on for a sec, we're now going to kind of segue into treatments from all this biology that I've been subjecting you guys to. So Chemobrain is associated with a couple pretty common and also pretty treatable problems. So sleep disturbance is really common, fatigue, and also so what can be done? What's the action plan here? So I'm going to start out with, this is the order that I'm presenting this stuff in should imply no bias about my preferences. Like, there's many things that you can do for treatment, and they're all equally likely to be helpful. So I'm not putting medications first. I think they're the only way to go. So some people who have trouble with fatigue, with attention, with focus, can benefit from treatment with stimulants. And those are the medications that you guys have probably heard of for ADD in kids, things like Ritalin, Adderall, etc. And they have been studied for Chemobrain, actually. And unfortunately, the study that we have was negative, so they didn't really seem to help Chemobrain too much. But I've tried them for various patients. Some patients do find them effective for, you know, for fatigue, for sustaining energy, and for sustaining focus as well. So those things can be worth trying. Another medication that I've sometimes tried is called modafinil or Provigil, and it's a medication that sort of helps with fatigue and wakefulness. It's been used in, like, shift workers, people who work during the day because of sleep apnea. And it did, it actually, it was looked at in a group of breast cancer survivors who had fatigue, and it did seem to help their attention and memory in addition to their fatigue. So that's something that's worth considering. With concentration, it can actually cause very similar cognitive problems to Chemobrain. So it's not something that you want to, you don't want to ignore the contribution of potentially having depression or anxiety. Also some anxiety medications. It's important to use anxiety medications and sleep medications very cautiously because medications like Ambien and Ativan and, Klonopin, Lunesta, those are all sedative medications, so they can actually contribute to people getting cognitive problems sometimes. So the key is, use them, but use them with caution, try to take the lowest dose that you need. Because those things can actually cause memory problems on their own, even over and above Chemobrain. So I always I actually had one patient with Chemobrain who was working full time, and she'd had a lot of chemotherapy, so we thought, well, it could be the chemo, but she was also on Ambien because she had started to have insomnia during her chemo. And so about 6 to 9 months after her chemo, we decided to just try tapering the Ambien and see if that helped. And once she came all the way off the Ambien, her Chemobrain went away entirely. It was gone. It was really unbelievable. So not everyone can do that, but if you can, if there's any way to peel back on medications that might have cognitive side effects, you should definitely do that, because it could make a huge difference. So just a really interesting point about antidepressants, which I think is relevant to this talk. Antidepressants actually have been shown to increase levels of one of those neural growth factors that we talked about. They also have been shown to increase the growth of new neurons and increase the branching of connections between neurons. So this is a picture of a neuron with a bunch of dendrites, which are interconnections at the end of axons, and it seems to cause more branching and more connections. So it's possible that in some patients, antidepressants could help cognition. We don't know if this is true for all patients or just for overall as a group, but it's something worth thinking about. If you're depressed, that can affect your brain function too. So, okay, now onto some of the non-medication things you can do for your cognition. So, I know it's hard to exercise. I mean, I actually personally find it very hard to exercise regularly. That being said, if you can find a way to have regular aerobic exercise. By aerobic, I mean just kind of a fast walk. It doesn't have to be running, just a fast walk. That is actually one of the best things you can do for your brain. Exercise has been shown to, increase cell proliferation in that area of the brain that we talked about, the dentate gyrus, the hippocampus. And also, they did this, there was recently a review of a bunch of studies that were done about, things that you could do to prevent dementia, like crossword puzzles and Sudoku and, reading and all kinds of things. And they looked at exercise as well. And exercise was actually the only factor that seemed to conclusively lower the risk of developing dementia. So it seems to make sense that it could improve Chemobrain as well, so I always recommend it. And I would say, I think even small amounts, if you haven't been exercising, just start with a little bit of walking and just work it up really gradually, 5 minutes per week, of the length of your walks, take it really slowly. The other thing that's helpful, there's been some studies that suggest that having a good social network, having as many connections as you can with a variety of people, can actually stimulate your brain to form new connections and new synapses. So the more you can do socially, the better off you're going to be, so to fight against any tendency to sort of isolate yourself. And then good nutrition is also important for cognitive function, and I actually, my bias is that nutrition can be a really challenging area because you hear a lot of different things from different people. It's good to get omega-3s. You can actually buy them over the counter and take them. I think that's actually been studied and helpful in depression as well, depression and other types of mood disorders. So it can't hurt you to do more omega-3s and just looking at antioxidant content in your diet. And you can get more, I would come to the seminars and get more information about that in terms of diet. So So sometimes it's confusing if you're having Chemobrain. Like, when do you, like, how long do you wait for it to go away? When do you get help? Like, who do you, who can help you with this? So I wanted to give kind of a roadmap, like, for, you know, when you might consider getting help. So I think, like, I usually tell people wait 6 months. You know, if you've had chemotherapy, you got to give yourself 6 months to really recover. If you're more than 6 months out and you're having, if the problems that you're having with Chemobrain are, like, to get neuropsychological testing. So you can ask your oncologist for this referral, or really your PCP could help you with this referral too. We have a good group of neuropsychologists at the Brigham down the street, like sort of on Longwood Ave, who have a lot of experience working with Chemobrain patients. So the reason for this is because that testing really can give a good window into what you're dealing with to rule out anything like dementia, and to make sure that what's going on is more consistent with Chemobrain and not something else. And it also gives a lot of information about sort of your strengths and your weaknesses that can be used to help you tailor sort of some strategies. So if you have a family history of dementia that's concerning you, or if you have other neurological symptoms, like let's say you have really bad neuropathy, or you have a lot of headaches, or you have something more, you know, if you have weakness or numbness in any parts of your body, you might consider seeing a neurologist as well, just to make sure there's nothing else going on neurologically that's being mistakenly attributed to Chemobrain. If you have sleep problems, fatigue, depression, anxiety, you could consider seeing a psychiatrist. We deal with that kind of stuff a lot. And you could also consider seeing a sleep medicine physician if you're having problems with snoring, with waking up in the middle of the night. and then finally, like, whatever you do, just make sure your primary care doctor is in the loop, because they can really help with referrals, and they can help, you know, make sure that all the specialists are, like, communicating and that your care is, like, well coordinated, which is really important because it gets very confusing. Lots of specialists. So sleep apnea. So one, I have seen some sleep apnea in patients who have had breast cancer, and one of the reasons is that unfortunately people tend to gain some weight with their breast cancer treatment. Like a lot of other cancer types, you lose weight, but with breast cancer, unfortunately, a lot of people gain. So that can put you at higher risk of getting sleep apnea. Also with different types of brain tumors, sometimes you can get sleep apnea. There's a higher risk for apnea as well. Masks are, so a lot of my patients are really scared to go and have a sleep study because they're really scared they're going to have sleep apnea and they're going to have to wear a mask and it's not going to be comfortable. And they are more comfortable than they used to be. So there are some masks that now go over the nose only, not the mouth. And they can also put in humidified air so that everything doesn't get like dried out. So don't give up. Like if you have sleep apnea, you get a mask, it's not comfortable, like tell them it's not comfortable. Ask if they can do anything to fix the setup. And then the other key is to start with just a few hours a night. Just start with like, you know, 1 hour a night, 2 hours a night, and then work up gradually. If you even wear it for only 5 or 6 hours, you're going to get most of the benefit. So you don't have to wear it for every single second of the night if you have this. So it's worth getting tested if you have any snoring, that if you have loud snoring, or if you have like apneas where like you wake up stopping breathing. So I'm just going to say really quick, I'm not going to go over it again. So CBT it might not change your Chemobrain, but it could change your relationship with your Chemobrain. So I'll explain that in a second. So this is sort of the way that we think cognitive behavioral therapy works. It's like, what sort of negative thoughts are you having that could be affecting your mood, your emotions, and your feelings? And how does that in turn affect your behavior on a day-to-day basis? And then physical reactions, you can substitute that in your mind with Chemobrain. So you can see your Chemobrain might make you depressed, think like, I'm not worth it, I can't do my job. It might make you then like withdraw from people and withdraw from things because you feel like you're worried about having these things happen. So then there becomes sort of a vicious cycle where like you're not doing the things that you could be doing to like expose yourself to things that are scary and to get help. So I'm not going to belabor this because we don't have that much time. So just I'm a psychiatrist, so I'm biased. I'm just going to talk about this for 2 seconds. The other thing that I think is really helpful, like when you're struggling during survivorship, is to sort of remember that whenever you're feeling anxious about something, it's a signal of an emotion that lives underneath that anxiety. And so I've listed here some like primary emotions. Doesn't get like secondary colors, like a palette. So there's actually been research showing that if you're able to name your emotions more accurately, you can reduce some of the anxiety that happens. And some of these things that you do in therapy might actually also help your chemobrain. So just a couple more really quick things, and then we're going to have a few minutes for questions. So cognitive rehab, I can't say enough about how helpful this can be. I have had a few patients who have really found this like life-changing in terms of being able to work with their symptoms. So cognitive rehab is sort of like, you can think of it like PT or OT, and in fact it's covered by the same type of insurance as PT and OT. And it's done by a speech language pathologist usually, and they'll meet with you like once a week for an hour, and you'll get a lot of homework, you know, exercises to sort of retrain your brain, to sort of track what causes your cognitive symptoms, to know what your triggers are, and to try to minimize your triggers whenever possible, to have coping strategies, to sort of like, you know, have notebooks, note-taking, PDAs, just developing an organizational system that works for you, and then using that system consistently. They will work with you to make sure that it happens and that it works for you. So the cognitive rehab that I refer to frequently around here is at Mass General Hospital, and there are also a few providers in other places. Like, I have a list, which if any of you are interested, I can share it with you sometime after the session. So the idea behind cognitive rehab, right, is to sort of compensate for the chemo brain problems. So it's sort of like, let's say you're a tennis player and you have a terrible backhand. Like, you just build up your forehand so it's so good that you can run around the court and like do everything with the forehand, but your backhand is still bad. So like, but what if you want to have a good backhand? You know, what if you want your backhand to come back, you know, in the case of chemo brain, where like you want those skills that you used to have to be, you know, to be working again. So the idea is this is compensatory, but we don't know about what about something restorative that could really restore your function the way it used to be. So the newest developments in chemo brain are actually trying to take advantage of like the plasticity of your brain to restore function. And so brain plasticity means basically that, you know, even at, we used to think this was only the case in kids, but really even in older, so if you, you know, strengthen your social connections, or if you take a dance course and you learn like a new dance step, you're like strengthening wiring in your brain and building new wiring. Whereas if you forget a word, that's sort of like an idea of where the wiring is being lost. You can build new wiring by doing different things. So there's actually a website. I hold no commercial interest in anything that I talk about in this talk, by the way. So this is just things that I found things that people have found to be helpful. So there's this POSIT program, which is a program that's been studied in mild cognitive impairment and also age-related cognitive issues. It's like a 40-hour training. There's a website, and there's a lot of free stuff on the website that you can do as well, or you can order it if you like it. And it's currently being studied in Chemobrain, you know, by a researcher in Australia, and definitely update this talk with the study results when they come out. So then the other thing is, this is something that I've been investigating recently, is EEG biofeedback, otherwise known as neurofeedback. Basically where you set up EEG leads at several places on your head, and that tracks the activity, the brainwave activity. And there's different types of this neurofeedback, but the one that I know most about involves like listening to relaxing music while you're hooked up. And the software will then measure the brain waves and determine how much turbulence is. And basically, turbulence is a measure of how much amplitude is changing of the brain waves. Like, normally we have some amplitude changes, but not too much. Whereas it seems that some people with chemo brain, or you know, anxiety or depression for that matter, have a lot of rapid amplitude shifts. And so the software will like create a pause in the music if you have like wild amplitude changes, and then when your brain calms down, the music will come back on. So the idea is like to minimize pauses in the music, your amplitude will calm down and become more smooth. So there was a study that we did, like we're trying to get it published right now, where some breast cancer survivors did this type of treatment and really had a lot of improvement in their self-reported cognitive function, their sleep, and their fatigue after they did 20 sessions of this. So this needs to be studied much more before we can really fully recommend it. We need to do more study with neuropsychological tests and with probably with brain imaging too. But just some, you know, this is another option that's out there for people. So final thing, and then we'll do questions. I just want to, you know, you have to be alive to have Chemobrain. So I think, like, I want to send a hopeful message, you know, with this, which is that most people, if not all people, gradually improve over time. That the only reason you have this is because you are a survivor and you came out on the other side. And so I think that it's important to put all of this into a larger perspective, too, about, you know, your cancer treatment. Thank you all. You've been a great audience. If you have any more questions, Sarah can let you know how to get in touch with me.
All right. Thank you all so much. Thank you.